And I'll begin reading at verse 20. Then Jesus looked up at his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets. But I say to you that, listen, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who begs from you. And if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them do to you." The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. And let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So this is All Saints Sunday, the day on which we remember those saints who once lived among us, those saints we loved because they perhaps worshipped right here with us and taught us so much about what it meant to be a disciple of Christ. We remember those saints we loved because they raised us, or we were raised up with them, or we raised them as our own. Perhaps the loved ones we remember were our parents, or a spouse, a sibling, dear friends, or one of our children. We give pause to remember them and give God thanks for their love in our lives. Some of us still grieve the loss of these saints as their deaths have left holes in our lives and emptiness. So today we gather and face that emptiness together and remember. We both remember our loved ones, and we remember, come together, reattach as a community of faith, as we allow ourselves to let the saints teach us about living and what it means to be a faith community that follows the teachings of Jesus. So as pastor, when I meet with grieving families, my purpose is to get them to talk to me about their loved one. What will they always remember? What stories that you love to tell about your loved ones? What stories their loved ones would love to tell about you? And what their loved one taught them about faith, about being a disciple of Jesus? And quite frankly, it is always that last question that is the hardest for most churched families. Unchurched families tend to be more spiritual than religious, more about, "Yeah, he believed in God," rather than what you normally would hear from a church person. She modeled a life of Christ, and this is what I learned from her about being a disciple of Jesus. That sentence is so hard for us to finish. But I wonder, have any of us ever given thought to what others might say about us when we die? About what they would say about our faith in God through Christ, about how we practice or struggled with practicing forgiveness, grace, and mercy with those who truly tried our patience. And if we haven't given thought to what others might say about us when we are gone, today is a good day to give that own thoughts. This past year, 6 members of faith, this community of faith, died and joined the church triumphant. They were Henry Brazier, Hal Talbot, Mercedes Graber, Gisela Naylor, Carolyn Brazier, and Grace Wolfe. Some of the funerals were held here in this sanctuary. Others were held elsewhere. The impact that the pandemic had on the church, the Big C Church, not just this church, the when and how we celebrated the lives of members who died, the ways in which we sought to support families in the grief, the ways in which the community gathered or remained scattered during those times of loss, truly impacted the way that we lived into that scripture from 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I'm going to read a portion of that from for you, where it says, "For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. But God has so arranged the body that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice with it." The reality here at Faith is that up until about 8 months ago, the way that this community grieved for the past 2 years was vastly different than what it was pre-pandemic, and again, vastly different since. And what we lacked in the interim, that time between shutdown and when mask mandates were lifted, was that sense of community like we had before, right? And we have longed for that type of community once again, and each and every day. But for those families who lost loved ones during that interim time, they also lost the grief support that comes from faith communities like this one. They missed out on the hugs, the face-to-face spoken words of comfort and support. They missed out on those post-funeral luncheons where members of the faith community gathered around tables, yes, to eat, but to also share memories and stories about their loved one. And it is my hope, and I'm sure yours as well, that we will continue to find ways to support each other in our common loss of a member in this body of Christ. Whether we are gathered or scattered, we should always share words of comfort and support, as well as stories about our brother or sister here at Faith, who taught us more about our own faith and called us to be better disciples or followers of Christ. I mentioned earlier that 6 members of Faith died this past church year, and of those 6 members who died, I presided at one funeral and attended another off-site. The off-site funeral was that of Carolyn Brazier. So for the Brazier family, this past year was a tough one. Henry, Dad, died about a year ago, and then Carolyn, Mom, died in June. The stories that I remember were shared at Carolyn's funeral involved family and friends that they would host at their farm near Brenham. Over and over, I heard how much Henry and Carolyn and all of the guests enjoyed the farm, the great outdoors, and Carolyn's cooking out there. Henry and Carolyn's love for the great outdoors and providing a space for people young and old to gather was probably what gave them their idea for their legacy project. If you have ever been to Luther Hill and stayed in or sat on the porch of the Brazier Center, then you know something about the legacy that they left. Henry and Carolyn's financial support of that structure has meant that hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands by now, of campers, adults, and youth alike stayed in and anchored their memories of faith-based discussions, game nights, solitude on the porch swing, or a Sabbath time away from the busyness of life in that suite of cabins. And while I never met either Henry or Carolyn in person, I stand here as someone who benefited from their foresight, who enjoyed a good number of retreats in the Brazier Center, and continue to think of the many ways in which I either enjoyed my Sabbath and slept quite soundly at camp, or enjoyed the company of fellow clergy on retreat. In May, I had the honor of preaching all around. She only had her one son, Harold, and beyond the places that they worked, this was the only place where Gisela and Harold found community. I don't know how many of you knew them. They were Heritage Service folks who sat in that area right there. Gisela knew the importance of faith and sought to make sure that she and Harold were here every single Sunday. She taught Harold how to pray every night, and she knew that this faith community would be a good one in which to both raise her son and know that he would always be welcome here. On the day of Gisela's funeral, I truly expected only a handful of people to be present. They didn't interact much with the rest of the church. They were truly kept to themselves. But that was not the case the day of the funeral. A good number of faith members came because they knew Gisela, or you came to support Harold, or because you were living into the scripture from 1 Corinthians. If one member suffers or grieves, all suffer or grieve together with it. I cannot tell you how much your presence that day meant for Harold. This faith community was there when he needed it most. Harold has been through a lot since his mother's death, and I would encourage you to continue to hold him in prayer as his life and living situation continues to change. There were three other members of faith who died, whom I did not know, but you in your collective memory did. Hal Talbot, Mercedes Graber, and Grace Wolfe. And I would invite you to remember their faces and perhaps how they lived out their faith. And even if you didn't know any of these church members, I would encourage all of us to remember the saints in our lives who taught us about a faith in God through Christ and who showed us how to live into our faith. And then I would invite us to give some thoughts as to how we allow faith to inform and transform our lives. Lastly, I would invite us to consider how we invite others to a faith in God and how we show others how life is lived as a disciple of Christ. Again, this is All Saints Sunday, a day to remember those who have died, as well as a day to remember how their faith shaped our living, so that we can learn how to better shape our lives around our faith in Christ. Our choices about how we live faithful lives are models for others around us, and they will live on in the memories of those we leave behind when we die. Hear these words from Ephesians chapter 1. They're from the Message translation, and I'm beginning at verse 15. Paul writes, "That's why when I heard of the solid trust you have in Jesus and your outpouring of love to all the followers of Jesus, I couldn't stop thanking God for you every time I prayed. I think of you and give thanks, but I do more than thank, I ask. I ask the God of Jesus Christ, the God of glory, to make you intelligent and discerning in knowing him personally, your eyes focused and clear so that you can see exactly what it is he is calling you to do. Grasp the immensity of this glorious way of life he has for his followers. And what is it that Christ is calling us to do? This morning, we read a portion of Jesus' sermon on the plain in Luke. Again, these are guidelines for living a life in Christ, that we might be called saints after our death. And the translation, again, I'm using this from the Message. I happen to love the Message when it comes to the Sermon on the Mount or the Sermon on the Plain, just because there's no beating around the bush what Jesus is trying to get across to us. So the blessings. You're blessed when you've lost it all. God's kingdom is there for the finding. You're blessed when you're ravenously hungry, because then you're ready for the messianic meal. You're blessed when the tears flow freely. Joy comes with the morning. And then there are the woes. But it's trouble ahead if you think you have it made. What you have is all you'll ever get. And it's trouble ahead if you're satisfied with yourself. Yourself will not satisfy you for long. And it's trouble ahead if you think life's all fun and games. There's suffering to be met, and you're going to need it. There's trouble ahead when you live only for the approval of others, saying what flatters them, doing what indulges them. Popularity contests are not truth contests. Look how many scoundrel preachers were approved by your ancestors. Your task is to be true, not popular. To you who are ready for the truth, I say this: love your enemies. Let them bring out the best in you, not the worst. For those of us gathered today to remember the saints, may their lives inform our living, and may the words and teachings of Christ inform our faith and our living, that one day we may be disciples worthy of the title of saint. Amen.